Good evening and welcome to the Joy of Living speaker meeting. My name is Marcella, I'm an alcoholic. Let's start this meeting with a moment of silence followed by the preamble. A preamble. Alcoholics Anonymous is a fellowship of men and women who share their experience, strength, and hope with each other that they may solve their common problem and help others to recover from alcoholism. The only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. There are no dues or fees for a membership. We are self-supporting through our own contributions. A is not allied with any sect, denomination, politics, organization, or institution, does not wish to engage in any controversy, neither endorses nor opposes any causes. Our primary purpose is to stay sober and help other alcoholics to achieve sobriety. This meeting is being recorded and will be available in our YouTube channel in a few hours. The format of this meeting is that one of us speaks for half an hour and then we're open for shares. And tonight's speaker is our very own Tommy. Tommy, whenever you're ready, we'll listen to you.
Hi, everybody. My name is Tommy, and I'm an alcoholic. I took my first drink in Texas when I was 13 years old. And I took my last drink in California when I was 28 years old. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what my life, very little about what it was like when I was drinking, because I really don't have much of a what we call a drunkalogue. Nothing that I did was going to scare you sober, but there are some things that we can identify with. So I'd like to qualify. What qualifies me for membership in Alcoholics Anonymous is simply my desire to stop drinking. Now, how I got that desire, it was not, it didn't come natural to me. That was the last thing on my mind when I came to Alcoholics Anonymous, is that I would stop drinking. I came for alternative motives. I wanted to find out how I could keep drinking and not get into so much trouble, because I was just internal trouble. My life had been so chaotic for so long. Always trying to juggle my drinking with my obligations, my work, my family life, all of that sort of stuff. Always trying to juggle things. And it was just so hard. I didn't know anything about Alcoholics Anonymous. I had never met anybody that said that they were in Alcoholics Anonymous. So I didn't know anything about it, except that in the depths of my last drunk, I remembered a movie, The Days of Wine and Roses. It was Jack Lemmon and Lee Remick, and it was a 60s classic. For any alcoholic serious about their alcoholism, I highly recommend it to you. And in that movie, it's about their drinking, and the man went to, I thought it was AAA, that's how much I knew about it, but he went through a thing called Alcoholics Anonymous, and that clicked, and he did something else. He saw himself in the mirror, and he saw himself as he really was, a damned old drunk. Just a drunk, and he didn't even recognize himself. And I went to the mirror and watched myself drink, and I had the same feeling. I could not recognize who I saw in the mirror, and I certainly didn't like who I saw in the mirror. And I went to the phone book. It was in Vallejo, California, in the summer of 1974. And I went to the phone book, and in the phone book there was I found Alcoholics Anonymous, and it said call anytime. I don't remember what time it was, but I'm sure it was after 10 o'clock. Maybe it was 2 o'clock. I don't know what time it was, but I called that number and I got the answering service, and they said, hang on, we'll get somebody to talk to you. And a wonderful man by the name of Paul came on the line, and he talked so calmly and so gently and so encouragingly about his drinking. And he talked about not drinking one day at a time. And then he did something that bordered on the miraculous. He invited me to his meeting. And when is it? Because I'm thinking, oh, surely, you know, it's probably once a week. Yeah, I probably got another couple of days I could keep on drinking because I still had alcohol left. And I thought, oh, another thing he said, I will come over to your house. If you would like me to come over and talk to you more, I will come over. And I didn't want that because I think I still had booze to drink. And I had tried pouring alcohol out before, and I couldn't leave it poured out. I'd go shake the pennies out of my daughter's piggy bank and go replace it if I did. So I knew better than to just pour it out. And so I said, no, I'll come to your meeting. And so the next day I spent the whole day trying to get sober. Well, I went to the gym, I sat in the sauna, I did all kinds of things that a 28-year-old would do to, quote, get sober. And I went to the meeting, and my life has never been the same since. Because I found the kindest and most interesting people I had ever encountered in my life. And I've met some interesting characters. I've sailed the world. I've met some interesting characters. But these people were just kind and gentle and welcoming. And I don't know. I think I fell in love with them immediately. I sat through their meeting, and then they did that miracle again. They invited me back. And I came back the next night. And I came back the next night. I'm going to tell you a little side story about the next night, because remember, this is my third Alcoholics Anonymous meeting. And it was a Saturday night, and it was birthday night. And they had like a cake for this guy. And they got him up, and he spoke, and he was clean, and he was articulate, and he was sober, and he said he had not drank for a year. He also said he was a chief petty officer in the United States Navy. I was in the Coast Guard. I was a sailor too, and a chief, and I never knew a chief that didn't drink. And I was absolutely in awe of this man. Now I'm going to fast forward to last Friday night. I was at a meeting, a Zoom meeting, at the Vallejo Fellowship, because I was able to find them again. I found them again. And I was at a meeting, and that same man was there. His name was Jose. I get teary just thinking about it. He was there 47 years after that first, my third Alcoholics Anonymous meeting, his first birthday meeting. These are things you can't make up. These things don't happen to people like me when I drink. They'd grab me by the seat of the pants, and they'd say, USOB, don't you ever come back in this bar again. We don't want you around. Don't come back here. And yet the people in Alcoholics Anonymous, they said, oh, just keep coming back. Just keep coming back. I bought a big book at my first meeting. I bought the book Alcoholics Anonymous, and I still have that book stashed away someplace. And inside that book is a little card that has Vallejo Fellowship stamped on it, that I picked up at my very first meeting 46 years ago. You see, my last drunk was the night before my first meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous. I don't count my sobriety from then, because I had to test this thing. I needed to know if I'm a real alcoholic. I needed to know it was true that the real alcoholic who picks up a drink and starts to drink again will pick up as though they never stopped. I tried it, and I did. I picked up as though I never stopped. And it shook me. It shook me to the core. I count my last drink as about with NyQuil, for crying out loud. Who would have thought? I got a cold. And so I go buy some cough medicine. And I don't read the label. That stuff was 17% alcohol. There's wines that aren't even that much, don't even have that much alcohol in them. And so I start coughing a little bit and I take a shot. Comes with a shot glass on the top, if you don't know. And so I'm pouring the stuff out and I take a drink and I pour it and cough again, take another drink. And then I felt the alcohol. And because I had been coming to the meetings, because I knew better, I knew what it felt like to come on to alcohol. Another miracle happened. I set it down, I put it away, and I did not drink it again. Ah, finally, freedom. So what's it like? What's it like in this world to live, be an alcoholic and live sober? You see, I've come to believe that it's the truth that sets the alcoholic free. And those people told me the truth about alcohol. How once it goes bad, it's never going to get good again. That it, nothing, no amount of meetings would make alcohol good again for me. I'm alcoholic. I lost my ability to control my alcoholism. My consumption of alcohol. And I was never going to get it back again. And no amount of meetings, no amount of sobriety, 46 years isn't long enough, not near long enough to make it good again. So what did I have to do? I had to have a change of attitude and outlook on everything, on life, on people, on God, on money, on employment, on fatherhood, husbandhood. Everything had to change. And it began with a change of attitude and outlook. I had to stop grieving the loss of the alcohol. I had to let that go and realize that alcohol wasn't something I had given up. It was something that I had gotten rid of. It was like a skin cancer, and I went and got rid of it. What a fool I would be to go sit on the beach and get skin cancer again. What a fool I would be. Knowing what I know now, doing what I have done since, to go back to there. And then there comes the good news. The good news. Okay, I'm going to, I've still got a few minutes here, looks like. I'm going to read something out of the big book because it's very, very important. Because everybody tells you, the first 164 pages, that's the one to read. Old Tommy's telling you it's the first 169 pages. So if you got a book and you can find it on page 169, but you see it's not numbered. So you might have to count it up. You might have to go 164 and then count up. And it looks like this. There's a blank page on one side. And then on the other side, it says this. The pioneers of AA. Dr. Bob and the 9 men and women who here tell their stories are among the early members of AA's first groups. All 10 have now passed away of natural causes, having maintained complete sobriety. Today, hundreds of additional AA members can be found who have had no relapses for more than 50 years. All of these then are the pioneers of AA. And here's the key thing. If you don't remember me, but if you'll remember these words, your life can change. Talking about Dr. Bob, talking about those pioneers, it says this: they bear witness that the release from alcoholism can really be permanent. Oh, what good news. What good news. I don't have to drink again. The release from alcohol that I found in Alcoholics Anonymous will last me a lifetime, one day at a time. If I don't forget, I got a built-in forgetter. I'm apt to forget that I'm an alcoholic, unless you remind me. I need you so bad to remind me over and over again. Alcoholics Anonymous doesn't cure alcoholism. It never cured mine. I like to add this, and I only speak for myself. Alcoholics Anonymous doesn't cure alcoholism, but it cures stupid. It cured my stupid. I'm not near as stupid as I used to be. Not even close. I came to Alcoholics Anonymous, and every meeting I've been to for 46 years, I have at one time or another, sometimes the beginning and sometimes the end of the meeting, I have prayed for wisdom. Wouldn't I be a fool if I prayed for something? Maybe like praying for the lottery. It's never going to happen. But I prayed for wisdom, and God granted it to me. It's a very wise thing for me not to take that first drink. It's a very wise thing for me to not desert the fellowship that found me and cleaned me up and set me straight and gave me a life that I could not have ever dreamed of. I came to Alcoholics Anonymous. My dreams were dead. They weren't coming true. They weren't going to come true. And yet sobriety and the fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous resurrected those dreams and taught me how to make them come true. It said this. It said, work for them. Simply work for them. Oh, secret of the ages right there in that book. Ah. So what's it like today? What it's like today is I get to go to more meetings than I've ever gone to in my whole sober life. Thank God for Zoom. One door closes and then the whole world opened up. Can you imagine what an age we live in? To go to a meeting Ricardo from Mexico is here, and you guys, Marcella from Boston, and me from Port Angeles, Washington. That's in the very corner of the continental United States. When I look out my bathroom window, I can see Victoria, British Columbia. All over the world we are. And I'm not trying to sell anybody anything. I'm not here to tell you what you need to do. You need to straighten up and fly right. Everybody's always telling me, you better straighten up and fly right. Yeah. Nobody ever told me how to do it, though. In Alcoholics Anonymous, they said this, here's how we do it. Here's how we do it. We do it one day at a time by not taking the first drink and by associating together, by encouraging each other. Encouragement. See? That's what I needed. I needed so little encouragement, but I found it in Alcoholics Anonymous that keep coming back. Come on, we can do it. You can do it. We can do it together. These were things that opened the world to me. And because I sobered up, because I took that last drink, because I believed what I was told, I kept coming back and kept coming back. And the very dreams of my childhood came true. All I ever wanted to do was be a simple sailor. I tell people, I'm an 18th century sailor that got stuck in the 21st century. My dream was to sail on tall ships. And when I'd climb a tree when I was 8 years old, I was climbing a mast. One of these days, I'm going to sail the seven seas. Well, I did. And like I told my wife once, I took her sailing, and she got a little queasy, shall we say. And just a just a little queasy. And I said, oh, sweetie, don't worry about it. I've thrown up in every ocean of the world. You see, seasickness will not keep a sailor from going to sea any more than a hangover will keep an alcoholic from drinking. Never stopped me from drinking just because I was miserable with a hangover. So what it's like today, I still have a boat, still dream of sailing, and I still go sailing. But you know what? It wasn't until I was 65 years old that I got to sail on that tall ship, and eventually got to captain that tall ship. When I say dreams come true in sobriety, I mean it from the depths of my heart. There I was. It was like in the Bible: when I said come, they came; when I said go, they went. What a wonderful time. So wherever you are in your sobriety, it means nothing about how young you are. The younger, the better. It means nothing about what you drink or how much you drink or how much you didn't drink. Don't ever let anybody spill more than you ever drink, sonny boy. Doesn't matter. Work on that desire to not drink. And walk through those steps. Those steps will take you on a journey worth taking. Okay? Just taking a few steps isn't a journey. But when you take all of them, in that book, it talks about walking a happy distance. Well, it talks about trudging. Okay? Trudging. What's that mean? What's that word? I looked it up. It means to walk with purpose towards a goal. Trudging towards a happy destiny. All I want to do is just say, if I can do it, you can do it. And together we can do wonderful things. We live in such a world. It is so heartbreaking. Pandemics, how about the pandemic of alcohol, drugs, resentments, pandemic all over the world. And yet here comes Alcoholics Anonymous, and it says, we have a solution. Change of attitude, change of outlook, a change of mind, a change of heart. How do we do that? How do you do that? By changing our actions. I had to change my actions. Instead of going to the bottle for an answer, I came to Alcoholics Anonymous and got the right answer. I let my legs do the walking. I let my mind follow me to the meetings, and they bathed me in the truth. And the truth is that your last drink can be your last drink. Your last drink can stay your last drink. Drinking again will not make getting sober easier. It only makes drinking again easier. The thing that makes getting sober easier is staying sober. I had a dear friend that I met her in my third year of sobriety when I first moved to Seattle, Washington in 1970. What was it? 1978, 1977? It doesn't matter. But anyway, it was I met this dear lady, and then she just started popping up in my life. I'd see her on a street corner carrying a guitar, and I'd stop and, Irene, do you need a ride? Oh, yeah. She's always needing a ride. She never drove in her whole life. She had 10, 15 years of sobriety. My ship pulled into Juneau, Alaska once, and I can find a meeting. I found a meeting in Juneau, Alaska. I walk into this meeting in Juneau, Alaska, and there's old Irene in Alaska. She had come up there to visit her brother, and we want to go see my brother. I went with her to visit her brother. He was dying in a nursing home of Korsakoff's syndrome, wet brain, from all the alcohol he had drank. But she was sober. And so every time my ship pulled into, not every time, it makes it sound like it's decent, but when my ship would pull into Juneau, I would go visit John. And John would say this, old Irene, she's the good egg. She's the good egg. So we became friends. She was, let's put it this way. Irene passed away 3 years ago with 56 years of continuous sobriety. We had been friends for 40 years. I said all of that to say this. She would say things to me like this, Tommy, the obtaining is easy. It's the maintaining that gets hard. And she'd say things like this. She'd say, Tommy, get a tough skin. Get toughen your skin up so you can have a soft heart. If you got a thin skin, everything hurts and it hardens your heart. Get a tough skin and keep a soft heart. Who else is going to tell me that? Where else is somebody going to share things like that with somebody like me? In the Fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous. It's not a cult, not a religion. It is exactly what the preamble says it is. It is a fellowship of men and women sharing their experience, their strength, and their hope with each other that they can solve their common problem. I am absolutely certain that I have the common problem with you that you have with me, our inability to control our drinking. Thank you so much for listening to me. This is just so heartwarming. I'll turn it back to you, Marcella, if you'd call on people.
Thank you so much, Tommy. I don't see any hands up yet, so I'm going to get started. My name is Marcella. I'm an alcoholic. I feel very blessed. You painted with vivid colors the Fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous. And I am in awe at our group, The Joy of Living, because we're pretty new, right? Jay says that he published a meeting on December the 5th. It's only February the 17th. So we've been together for 2 months and 2 weeks. And I feel the Fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous in the Joy of Living. Like I look forward to see the familiar faces. I look forward to see old timers aging in sobriety. And I've made this my home group, not only because here is where I get what I need, but mainly because here is where I can give what was given to me. And I too have, at my age of sobriety, 12 years and a chunk, I have people in Boston that are my neighbors, that have become my family, people that are indispensable in my holidays and my family life, people that attended my wedding, that have been there for me through thick and thin, and people that will be with me for the rest of my life. And I'm meeting other ones, like all the windows that I see open right now. I know a little bit of you. And if any of you tells me, come to my house because you can help me with anything, if I can, I'll just jump and I say, here I am, just tell me what to do and I'll do it. Like I feel such a level of trust and safety. And when I'm afforded this level of trust and safety, I can open the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous I've never heard anybody, and I'm a big book junkie. I am addicted to this book. And I've never heard anybody read with so much solemnity. Page 169, I'm going to add it to my repertoire. Page 169, what an important message on page 169. I never have to drink again, ever. My release from alcoholism and all my alcoholic behaviors, because I have more than alcohol, can really be permanent. I'm not looking forward to be 46 years sober, because that means that I'll be like 100 years old. So I'm not looking forward to be so old, but it certainly makes me, you know, hope that by when I go back to my creator, and when it's my turn to experience God face to face, I'll be clean and sober. Thank you so much for your obvious commitment to this way of life, Dom. Okay, now I see Joanne. Joanne, would you like to share with us? I'm not going to keep time. You guys keep time yourselves.
Thanks. I'm Joanne, and I'm an alcoholic, and I'm glad to be here tonight. This is the first time that I've attended this meeting, but Tommy talks about it quite a bit and how much he really, really appreciates being here. And I really wanted to be here to hear him share with you. I've heard his story lots of times because I'm married to him, but it's always fresh. It's always fresh. And I always really enjoy his devotion and his enthusiasm for our program. And I certainly share that with him myself too. And I think one of the things that I heard tonight, especially, was the idea of the fellowship and how we are here together to encourage each other because we have a common problem. And if we look at the science of the day, the social scientists and the neuroscientists, they talk about that the feeling of well-being is one of the very important components of that is being able to relate to each other and to encourage each other and be a part of community. It's really a vital part of our living. And even in the pandemic, you know, I haven't really minded the pandemic that much at all, because I've been able to go to my Zoom meetings, and I've been able to see the people that I love and care about, that I can continue to have that village around me, and we can still relate to each other. And I kind of feel bad for the people who don't have that wonderful opportunity, because I think that's the magic of Alcoholics Anonymous, really, is for us to be able to share our common problem and to share our stories, and then to share how we work it out with each other. To the point where we can really be supportive of each other, of one another. And I always love talking about what's in the big book. It talks about the people on the big cruise ship or the Titanic who have this sense of camaraderie because they've been through something that was life-threatening. And here we are to talk about it with each other. So I'm really grateful for my sobriety. I'm really grateful for understanding what the steps can do for us. And I'm a real advocate of really paying attention to the steps and how they work out in our lives. And I see so many similarities with the world at large. Someone along the line said, I think it was Aldous Huxley, but don't quote me on that. But some fellow said that he thought that Alcoholics Anonymous was the greatest social revolution of the 20th century. And I tend to agree with him because it does embrace those principles and qualities that give us health and well-being. So I think our principles are universal. They don't just belong to us, but I also feel very privileged that in this particular iteration of those principles, I'm able to thrive. So I'm really grateful to be here. It took me a couple times to get here, but I will be celebrating, 18 years in August. I'll be sober for 18 years. So, and I'm very grateful for that. So thanks for being here.
Thank you, Joanne. Well, you always have a place with us where we can be your, we hope that you'll join us. It was lovely to meet you, Joanne. Rick Ricardo.
Hello, everybody. Good night. Rick Ricardo, Tommy, thank you. Thank you very much. What a beautiful words of hope to communion, to the him to be together as the solution to be sober. Every time that I hear you talking, I feel it. I get it from you. The way that you really share your message and how you spread the word of recovery really touch me every time that I hear you and really invite me to continue coming to the meetings, to find that comrade around the groups and try to help somebody as well as a part of the program that you've been described perfectly well. And to hear you every day, to hear you today, to know your story, it's amazing. I love that part that you kind of vomit in the seven seas. That was amazing. I love it. I will be fascinated to do something like that, at least a few. And your story to grow with your dreams and really the opportunity to do what you really want just because you find the sobriety, you find this person to really help you, to doesn't push you to do something, more invite you and welcome you and open the door in their hearts. And I guess that is the thing that you are passing to the rest of the people. And I really appreciate that you continue doing that after these 46 years, because it's a long time, and be consistent in a program for such a long time is admirable. And it's a hope. You show me that it's a hope of recovery. And if you are doing it, you are able to doing it, I probably will be able to doing it as well. Thank you very much, Tommy. Thank you, Marcella, for your coordination. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Fantastic meeting. Thank you, Tommy. I appreciate it a lot.
Thank you, Ricardo. Leslie?
I'm Leslie. I'm an alcoholic, and I'm grateful to be here. Tommy, thanks so much for your share. I've been coming to the Joy of Living in the mornings, and I'm always glad to see you. I always feel drawn to your spirit. And so it's a gift to hear your story. You're a master storyteller, your tone of voice and your cadence and the way you imitate people's voices is just so wonderful. And I feel like you embody to me the joy of living, the happiness and joy that you carry in your sobriety is just so hopeful and wonderful. And for me, holding aside getting sober, this past year has been probably one of the hardest years I've been alive. And, you know, people who remind us to find our joy are really, really, really special. And so I appreciate this group, and I appreciate how you as a person embody the spirit of the joy of the group. And I feel privileged to have heard your story. And I only hope that I will live as well and as long as you have. And thank you for showing me what that can be like.
Thank you, Leslie. Ellen, would you like to share with us?
Hi, my name is Ellen. I'm an alcoholic. Oh, Tommy, thank you so much for your lead. Every time you come on there, I feel such strength and wisdom from you. And I got that tonight. Man, I tell you, this program is just awesome. And you're right about the people we meet. We got some characters out there, didn't we? But there's some good characters in here too. So I just hope I get to keep hearing what you share because you teach me so much. So thank you, Tommy.
Thank you, Ellen. Greg, would you be so kind to share with us?
Thanks, Marcella. Hi, Tommy. Thank you so much. You know, since I've been coming to the, an inspiring story and an incredible power of example. But I've learned that since I've been coming to this meeting that I've been listening to what you have to say, and it always really touches me. And it, you have a way of putting things in addition to the words that makes me, that makes it really register. Yep, I have your common problem. And there's something that you talked about, which is the magic of this fellowship, which is, you know, I'm a guy who never really liked groups, but I really like this group and I really like AA. I'm a guy who doesn't like to be told what to do. Really doesn't like to be told what to do. But for some reason in AA, sometimes I don't like to be told what to do, but for the most part, I take suggestions and I learn to be teachable. It's a magical thing, and it's this fellowship and the way maybe it was designed, but maybe it's, I don't want to analyze it, but there is an incredible magic to what happened to me in this program and how I could actually learn to change my life after I learned to stay away from a drink a day at a time. You also said something that touched on, you know, something that's really pertinent to me, and that is this built-in forgetter. I got sober and enjoyed, and many of the promises came true for me and my life got better. And I can see, looking back on it, I went out and did an experiment, thinking about page 169, I should have been focused on that more. I should have been focused on a lot of other things, but I think I went out and did an experiment to see if I could drink again on about 2 weeks after my 25th anniversary in AA. And in my experience, I picked up just like I left off, and it did not get better. And in fact, it got a whole lot worse. I stayed out there for 5 years. And I'm back 5 years now, and with a different program, and it had to be. But one thing that I think that kind of scarred me at the beginning of coming back, I mean, there was an incredible relief and gratitude, but at the same time, there was a lot of shame and remorse and guilt and also pride, because which is so mis. It's just a swirling mix of stuff because I'm an alcoholic and I was active. Because this is how crazy the disease is that I was out there drinking, but yet after 25 years of sobriety, and yes, the last few years, I kind of let things lapse. And I stopped going to meetings. My sponsor had passed away and I didn't replace him just because he was irreplaceable, I felt, but it was, you know, I think he would have liked me to have replaced him. So I ended up fooling myself, thinking that I was still practicing the steps, if you can believe this, while I was drinking. I was still thinking I was doing a 10th step at night at the end of the day after having a lot of drinks. I was still waking up and thinking about doing a third step in the morning while I was hungover. And this is the insanity of our common problem. And at any rate, I am very, very grateful to be sober, and I'm very, very grateful to be able to hear people like you and your intensely powerful power of example that you give to me for free, and which is the magic of this fellowship. And thank you so much. See you tomorrow.
Thank you, Greg. I am going to take the liberty to read part of the page 17, There Is a Solution, where he talks about, you know, like the captain's table and that we survived the wreckage of the ship. But then it says in the last paragraph, it says that tremendous fact for every one of us is that we have discovered a common solution. I mean, because what brings us together is not the problem. Well, originally, right? At the very beginning, yes, we get together here because we have a problem. But what a boring party would be to be united around the problem. I wouldn't want to be around the problem. I'm here because we're around the solution. That's what really keeps us together. And the solution is, like Tommy said, a huge displacement of attitudes, ideas, and thoughts and feelings that brings me the joy of living, which some people call the spiritual experience. That's what brings us together and keeps us together. That's the party that never ends. That's the joy of living. Okay, Marty, say something to us, please.
Yeah, so one thing that just came to mind as you were saying that, you know, AA is not a support group. It's, you know, sometimes, and depending on which meetings you go to, AA can, you know, AA meetings can devolve into a support group, okay? But our meeting doesn't do that. Our meeting does more than that. Our meeting is a treatment. It's a cure. It's a remedy. It's something that, you know, I wake up every morning with, you know, untreated alcoholism, and I pray and go to my meeting, and I feel a lot better than I did before. And part of that is waking up sober physically. But, you know, a equally important part of that is getting to listen to people who do this for free, who wake up early and share things with me that I cannot get anywhere else. I can't walk around, a sporting event and tap on people's shoulders and say, hey, you know, I have this problem with alcohol. Any experience with that? How to get better? I can't, as a physician, tap my colleagues on the shoulder and say, hey, you know, any experience, strength and hope, that you'd be able to share with me regarding how you overcame alcoholism, just would not exist. And I can't also, you know, look it up in a textbook either, or even in this book. I depend on people like Tommy coming and showing me, here's what I did in order to do this. Here is the wisdom that I have to share. Here are things that kept me coming back. And here are things that now that I have a significant volume of experience doing, here are my insights. And sometimes I have to remember that they're not my insights. I can't finish Tommy's sentences. I might think that I can jump in there and know what he's going to say at the end. No, I can't. He has something that I do not have. And so I have to continually remind myself of that. And continually, every day is a new realization of just how grateful I am and should be and have to be for someone like that guiding me. It's truly amazing, Tommy, and I cannot thank you in the way that you deserve to be thanked. It's just not within my capacity, but what I can say is that my life has forever changed, and there's a ripple out from that. My wife's life is better. The lives of my patients are different and better. The lives of my family, the lives of my friends. I'm now called Uncle Marty by my friends' kids, first time ever. All of these things happen because Tommy comes to the meeting that, let's be real, I mean, it's, you know, unbelievably helpful for us, but Tommy's there to share and Tommy's there to give. And I understand that Tommy gets a little something back, but it's not in direct proportion to what is given. And so, you know, the fact that you wake up every day at an ungodly hour all the way out in Washington and share with me your experience, strength, and hope is truly, truly a miracle. And I just cannot thank you enough. So I'll pass it on.
Thank you, Marty, for those words. Like when you were talking, I say, yeah, like Tommy is the living embodiment of page 63, when we says, praying to God, take away my difficulties, that victory over them may bear witness. And bearing witness is what we read today on page 169. Bear witness. So there's Tommy to bear witness. Bear witness of thy love, thy power, and thy way of life, so that we may believe. 46 years sober, not any kind of sobriety, but happy, cheerful, optimistic sobriety, right? And I totally agree that there are many other groups in which they don't drink. God bless, God, thank God, right? But that's survival level, right? Like just not drink is just the very bare beginning, just not drink. But then the whole process is described in the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous with very, very detailed instructions of what to do, when, how. And the result is the spiritual awakening. The spiritual awakening is the key to the door of the joy of living that we can practice in all our affairs. Claudia, would you like to say something?
Hi, I'm Claudia. I'm an alcoholic. Thanks, Marcella. And thanks so much, Tommy, for your share. I've been attending the meeting for a while now, and I just get so much from every single meeting that I listen to. And, you know, I feel like I get too scared to share myself. So thank you, Marcel, for calling me, because I probably wouldn't have been courageous enough to raise my hand. I guess, you know, learning about AA, I've been 1 year sober, but I'm just newer to AA. And, you know, what you mentioned just earlier about, you know, being, you know, sober and not drinking is, it's just a piece of it. And it's an important piece, but, you know, I don't want to just survive. I want to, you know, have a good life and, you know, not be reactive and not have, you know, all the negative stuff that comes along with drinking, I guess that I drank to fill, it's, those holes are still there. So I know I need to work on myself. So I just, you know, I learned so much. There's so much wisdom in this, group. And, you know, I guess just like seeing you, Tommy, and others at the level that you are and the peace that you have in your life, it really inspires me and makes me want to do the work. And even though it's really still very like raw and hard at this phase for me, and especially the connection part, because I've isolated for so, so long. So it's just really uncomfortable. So for me to, you know, raise my hand or kind of try to, you know, say, you know, try to connect with people is really hard. It's just because I've just been so like closed off for so many years. So I just hope that with coming and listening and being courageous enough to do the work, that, you know, it'll get better. So I just really am grateful for, you know, all the meetings that you guys hold, and I get a lot from it. So thanks for letting me share.
Thank you, Claudia. We have time for Richo and then Veronica. Richo?
Thank you, Marcella. Good night, family. I am Richo. I am an alcoholic. Tommy, what can I tell you? Your words give me hope. When I hear you talking, well, the first thing I thought, I said, this Tommy is like the perfect grandfather for every kid. What you said, Marcella, that if sometime some of you come to my house to, if sometimes I have the luck that to receive you in Mexico, I will tell my kids, hey, this is our program, grandfather kids, hug him. No, I just want to read something about from page 15. We commenced to make many fast friends, and a fellowship has grown up among us, of which it is a wonderful thing to feel a part. The joy of living we really have, even under pressure and difficulty. So I am very new in the program, but I feel this change very fast, and I have hope, and this is like very important for me. It's amazing. It's amazing. 46 years. It looks for me like an eternity, but just go for 24 hours. Thank you, Tommy, and congratulations.
Thank you, Rachel. Veronica,
Yes, hi. I just wanted to thank you for your share tonight, but also every single day just showing up and providing so much to me and certainly other people as well. I struggle with sharing as well, as Claudia mentioned, for herself, but for myself, I also just struggle in revealing my past shame and my current shame of the past and remorse and guilt and having a group and, people like Tommy coming and inspiring me that I don't have to, be defined by that. And that, I think it was something that you said earlier before we started the recording, but you had mentioned that everybody has their own timetable and that life has so many different seasons. And those words just, they really resonate with me and mean a lot and give me hope for the future. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Veronica. Okay, so I guess this is the end of our speakers meeting. Thank you again, Tommy. We hope to see you tomorrow in case you wake up early again. Thank you, Joanne. It was lovely to meet you. Thank you so much for your AA marriage. I have my own as well. Yeah. Thank you so very much. Tommy, would you be so kind to lead us in prayer?
I will. And I'm going to read something just before. And it's found in the 12 and 12. Bill Wilson wrote this. And he says, it's on page 125 of the 12 and 12. Right at the very end of the treatise on step 12. And he says this, with each passing day of our lives, may every one of us sense more deeply the inner meaning of AA's simple prayer. So AA's got its own prayer. It goes like this. God, grant us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change. Courage to change the things we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. It's the we part that people so often forget. Thank you so much for allowing me to share with you tonight. Hopefully I'll see you in the morning.
Thank you again. See you tomorrow, guys.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay.
Good night, everyone.